So you're a new member of Heretoir. So I'm just
Yes.
I know some of you played together in King Apathy, and I'm just wondering, is that when you met the members, the other members, or did you guys already know each other, or how did that come to be?
No, we met actually years before, like 2 years before I joined Tränkind, which then renamed into King Apathy. when I played the show with my old black metal band and Heretoir was playing their first show there, then we just got in contact and first we became friends and then I started singing in Tränkind slash King Apathy. But I also recorded, has to be 2011 or 2012. I recorded session drums for Substance, is the record called. It's the re-recording of the old demo of Heretoir. And but it took like 4 more years, or like I think I joined in 2017. Because I just went out of one of my other bands and then I got some more time and so then I was able to join Heretoir.
So my understanding is that David took care of music composition overall in the past. He often programmed drums, but it sounds like you're helping with drum beats now for the songs, and he's making them around that. So what kind of changes to new material do you think you bring?
You're totally right. David writes all the music, and he also like years ago, he from a drummer who's a friend of ours, he bought some like drum patterns that he recorded at home. So he worked with not like really programmed drums, but with different patterns that another drummer did, and with the new songs, the album that will be out, I don't know. The drums are recorded. The rest will be done. I don't know. I step away from naming a time when an album will come out because there's so much stuff happening. So there's no date yet. But it worked that kind of the way that you mentioned. David wrote the songs with existing drum patterns. Here and there, I sent him a drum pattern and then he worked around it. But most of it, I just listened to the songs and then I just looked if I like what he did there or if I disliked it. Most of the time, I really like what he does because he has a really good feel for drumming, even though he's not a drummer and he can't play a single beat properly. But he really knows how drum parts and patterns can work in a song. And the most changes that I took are fill-ins and here and there a special beat or just having a different double bass pattern than he has in mind or something like that. Yeah.
That's exciting.
Yeah, it's a nice way to work.
And I was just gonna say, I saw a video of you and David talking, like it was just over a year ago, talking about the new material. There was a little sneak peek there on that.
Yeah.
So I was gonna ask you how much progress has been made. I know you're not gonna say in a date or whatever, but so there has
Yeah.
been a bit of progress.
The video that we released was from a pre-production. I'm very happy that at my parents' place we have a small recording studio. So for pre-production, I can go there, and that's the place where I recorded really, really rough drummings just to have a little snack for the people out there who are asking us for new material. And as I mentioned, the drums are recorded for the album, but especially with Corona hitting and a lot of different things that happened in our like social lives and our private lives, we agreed on just putting it as low as it needs to be at the moment, and the album will be out when it is out. But all the songs are written for the album. Drums are recorded, so it can be it. This is also a thing with this band because we're not professional Like we're not living off the music. We all have our day jobs. We have our families, and I think many bands can relate to that. And most of us also have other bands apart from Heretoir, and so there's a lot of stuff that's going on. And we really try to take off the pressure from us working and just delivering the album when it's done. And I think that's the most healthy way to work as a band, especially when you're not making money with a band and you're not really need the band to get food on the table or stuff like that.
Let the creativity flow when it flows, kind of thing.
Especially, yeah, especially, exactly, sorry.
Becoming someone that's serious about music, like, did it happen for you in an organic way, or do you feel like it was like a dream you had?
Yeah, that's a interesting question. I think very early I was interested in music. I think when I was around 3 or 4, I listened to AC/DC, Guns N' Roses, and stuff like that that my brother was listening to. And quite early, I remember I started playing the drums when I was around 8, and it all happened with watching Wayne's World. And Garth has this drum solo in the at the music store, and at the same time, Lars Ulrich, he really brought me into playing the drums, because he had like an advertisement in some metal magazines or something, and it was this huge white Tama set that he had on the recordings of the Black album, and I was totally hooked, and I thought, oh my god, I want to be a drummer. And then I asked my parents if I can get lessons, and I think when I was 8 I got lessons, and I was totally into Metallica, Iron Maiden, and stuff like that when I was really young. So I started playing the drums quite early, but I think I really started making music when I was around 12 or 13, putting my first punk band together, rehearsing at my parents' place. And I think it all came from one step to another. The first thing was to get a band together, and we were really shitty. Like, I think many, many young people who have bands are like quite shitty in the beginning. And then a friend of mine I met at school, he was like, don't you want to be in a metal band with me? And then we started, I was tired of this punk band split up, and I was a bit tired. I was around 16, got into Cannibal Corpse and I don't know, extreme black metal stuff. I wanted to play blast beats and double bass stuff. And so this came, and then we met another guy. And so I ended up being in two different bands, but they both were a little bit bigger. They were already playing shows outside of the hometown and having a record out and stuff like that. And so from that, I think when I was around 20 or something, I realized that it can be a bit more professional than just being at a rehearsal space on the weekends and play as fast as you can. Then it all just, so I would say it just came naturally for me, because I always loved music. I have music in my head the whole day. There's always something going on up here. And so I think I was very lucky meeting the right people that just helped me get into a band that was a bit more professional. And then I got into a doom band. So I had to learn to play very tight and very slow. And I was in a technical hardcore band. I had to play very fast and very technical stuff. So every little step that I did was, I think, well, it was good. And then I started singing in a band. I had to train my voice. I always wanted to be a singer, and then I became a singer. And so I think it all just step after step, and then I ended up where I am now, and I'm really happy, because a lot of things that I dreamed of as a child became true for me, like putting out albums, going on tour. That's like what I always wanted to do, and I'm super happy that I can do this.
That's great. So that you've mentioned a few times you've been in different bands and different styles and that, so that variety Does it keep you from being bored to just do different things, or do you need that?
I mean, I wouldn't really say that I totally need it, but my taste in music varies a lot. I mean, I would say the basic love is metal, but also a lot of punk rock and hardcore stuff, but more the melodic side of punk rock and like some heavy and death metal stuff and a lot of doom metal stuff. I think this is what I listen to the most, but there's also some Indian alternative stuff, some hip hop and rap stuff that I like. And I always like to try to do something new. And this doesn't mean for me that I have to put out music that tries to touch all those aspects that I like in one band, because I'm kind of a purist also. I usually like traditional heavy metal a lot, and I'm not so much into this new metal, modern metal stuff. There are great bands there as well, not really new metal, but in this more modern metal there's a lot of great stuff. But I would always prefer, I don't know, Slayer over, I don't know, Limp Bizkit or stuff like that. So this is like basically what I try to say here. But I think I wasn't so much that I ended up in playing in black metal bands and punk bands and hardcore bands and doom bands and death metal bands and stuff. It wasn't that I was looking for that. It kind of just happened, I would say, from one band. Then another person said, you want to start this project, or can you help me with this? And then I just jumped on board of a lot of different projects. So yeah, I wouldn't say that I'm getting bored in bands easily. I really like to stay as long as possible in bands. And Office is my old death doom band. I've been there for 10 years, and King Apathy was around 7 years. I think Heretoir will hopefully be for more than 10 years. This band Heretoir is just those are just my best buddies. It's like being with your best friends together and having a good time. So this is really, yeah, really kind of what I like the most, having a good time. When we play shows, we don't play that much. Like, it's sometimes, I mean, now it's Corona, but even before that, we play around 10 shows a year or something. And so every show is pretty, pretty special.
Yeah, I had heard that everybody in the band really enjoys the performance aspect. So
yeah.
How have you coped during the pandemic? I guess if you're doing 10, then you went down to zero.
Yeah.
Must have been hard on.
Yeah, I mean, we had, I think in 2017, we had like the most active year of the band. I think we played around 70 shows or something. It was insane for us, because next to working full time and stuff, I think we are happy, or we are lucky that it wasn't from playing 70 shows and really being like really needing the money of the shows to nothing. Even before Corona, we decided that we wanted to focus the next years more on the record and not play so much. So we had the last show in, I think it was June 2019. I think I can only speak for myself. I got really active during Corona. I started a record label. I started a new death metal band. I started playing the guitar. I was starting to get more, playing the drums more. And then we recorded the drums for the new Heretoir record in September 2020. So for me, there was a lot of stuff to do. And I started writing my master's thesis a few months ago. So I tried to keep myself busy as possible. And there's a lot of stuff apart from the musical aspects that I got to do in my life. I think for the others, yeah, I mean, some also wrote master's thesis or summer working, and there's a lot of stuff going on with everybody. And the bass player Matti, he's also the guy who wrote all the King Epiphy songs. He has a ton of more projects, and he's always writing and recording music. So there's, I think most of us were pretty busy with doing something. So yeah, using the time as good as possible.
Yeah, well, that's good. So what does performance do for you though, when you do perform? Is it an escape or more of like embracing yourself more fully? What is that experience?
I think speaking for myself, it differs a bit from being the drummer in Heretoir or being, for example, the singer in King Epiphy. For me, being a singer in King Epiphy was more an emotional aspect, and being the drummer in Heretoir for me is a bit of both. It's more trying to be as exact and playing as perfect as possible, and trying to give, especially Dave, he's... When you look at videos, I guess you hadn't been able to see us live, right? Because you're in Canada and we've never been overseas. So most of the performance is around him. He's the singer. He's like he's getting most of the attention. And for me, it's like I like to be there playing as exact as possible, so that he can. Put on a good show for the people, because he really is the emotional guy. He feels every song, and the people feel that he feels it. And I'm also feeling the songs. I really love to play them. But I think, and this is like for Max and Matti, the bass player, the guitar player, I think they are both kind of the same. They are standing on the sides, and Dave, he really loves, and he really lives for those 40 minutes or whatever time we play. And I think that people really appreciate that he's in with like always 100% each night. And that's, I would say that's what a Heretoir show looks like.
Yeah. So why do you think the band has taken a welcoming approach? It's not cliquey. It's basically like anyone's accepted, you know, like as far as fans, as far as, you know, why do you think the band has taken that approach?
If I understand you right, you mean that like kind of people from most or from any different like tastes and music can like the band?
I like everybody's welcome. Like I the outcasts are welcome, you know, everybody. That kind of way of thinking, yeah.
I think to me, and I can say that because I don't write the music, and I'm kind of a fan as well, and I got like into the band years after, and after the band already existed. So I think what makes this song what makes this band like kind of liked by a lot of people is that it kind of it's modern, but it's also very emotional. It's honest, I would say. I think it's a very honest band. There's not a lot of stuff. We don't have a backdrop. We don't have big stuff on the stage. It's just us people being on stage, and especially Dave, who's really an insanely good singer. He really feels the songs, and I think especially live, that's a point where even if people don't like the music so much, that they see it and they see a band that really loves what they are doing. I think this is, and also I would say that we try to be as inclusive and as open as possible, and this doesn't mean that we try to it's not like being meant on a musical side, more on a personal, private side. When we play live, we try to include everyone. We try to be as inclusive as possible, so that everyone can feel welcome at our shows. Because to me, it's like I don't want to be excluding people from shows. And especially if you're into playing like more emotional music, you have a lot of people who really have a strong connection to the songs. So to me, it's like also a little bit of, we try to take the listeners seriously, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
It's not like putting on a fake show, and it's just trying to connect as good as possible to the people. I hope I kind of answered your question.
For sure. It's like you're seeing people as people.
But... Yeah. And just, I mean, to me, it's really easy. I don't care as long as people are not assholes. And as long if a person is exclusive and if a person is, I don't know, for example, a racist, then I don't want the person at my show. But everyone who's open and free, like to let people be who they want to be, then the person is totally welcome. And I really like to spread this message, especially in the metal scene, to just let people be. If they are not assholes, if they are not treating people wrong, then just let us be this big metal like community or this family that everyone is talking about. I really love the idea behind it, but I think we have to fill this frame and being more like, I don't know, honest or something with this family. If we are a family, then we have to take care of each other.
Yes. I like that you guys talk about like not embracing hate. You know, like
totally it's important.
So is there any advice you would like to give your younger self?
I think this is something that I was thinking about a lot, because I told you that I started getting drum lessons very early, but I also quit like after a few months. And then I was 8 or 9. I was playing soccer with my friends and like playing stuff. On the one hand, I would say it would be very cool for me if I would have started those lessons and just stayed there. But on the other hand, I really like that I is autodidact. Is it a word in English? No, right? Like auto. No, I think it's in. I'm messing around with language. Like I never really had lessons playing the drums, like for a few months when I was young, and then I started just learning it by myself. And so I think I kind of like that my style of drumming. I mean, I'm limited as a drummer, but it's like all learned by myself. So this is like where I think on the one hand I like it, on the other hand I could be better as a drummer or as a musician. But on the other hand, I think, I mean, I'm not spiritual and stuff like that. I'm quite the what you say, like I'm more a realistic person. So but most of the time when stuff happened in my life, it led me to a place. And even though some places were shitty, in the end, it brought me to where I am now. And I'm super happy with my life, with who I am. So I think maybe just treat my friends a bit better. I try to treat them well, but I had times in my life where I've been an asshole, and just try not to be that asshole at the time of my life. I think this would be something that I think that my younger self would say, fuck you. So,
well, that's not a bad thing. I think we've all got things, right, that we could have, times when we've done something.
Yeah.
After it was sort of, yeah. So, I think it's brave of you that you openly talked about your mental health struggles. I think sometimes this is viewed as weakness, and that's wrong, obviously. So, I think that's great that you have openly talked about it. So, I just wanted to say thank you. I think it's important.
Thank you.
So myself, I often go to music for different moods. For example, when I'm excited or upset. Can you give me an example of a song you might go to for a specific mood?
So I just today I was at university and I was talking to friends about mood and music, and for me it's like you might laugh, but when I'm really down, there is always one record that really cheers me up, and that's the Final Countdown by Europe. Not the song, the whole album. It's ridiculously good, and they're like, this is a record I can be really fucked up and sad, but I put on this album and I'm getting happy again. There is one band that I can listen to nearly with all moods that I'm in, and this is Propaganda, especially all the stuff that came after John K. Samson left the band, especially Supporting Cast, which is my all-time favorite album, and it has so many different moods that I would say, if I think Propaganda just played a few shows in Canada, you should go to a Propaganda show. I would go if I had the opportunity.
I think I need to listen to them because I haven't heard too much from them, as crazy as that is. So
yeah, I mean,
that I think I will.
they are, like, to me it's a really, really special band because they have the deepest lyrics, and they are political, but they're also super personal. They are insanely technical on a musical level, but they're melodic, they are freshy, and it's like insane, and I love this band so much. Yeah, you should check out Supporting Cast by Propaganda.
Yeah, I will, for sure.
Nice.
So, and I wanted to say, I did check out A Mystery of Suffering, and I thought it was pretty cool. I'm just starting to check it out, but yeah,
thank you.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, this was the band that I started with a friend of mine from Gothenburg while we were in the pandemic. And yeah, and then we started the record label Cold Knife Records with a few friends of mine to get this album out. So it was like, yeah, just trying. I mean, it's a kind of a stupid idea at the moment to start a vinyl record label, but I mean, it doesn't have to be clever all the time. It just have to be from the heart. And so we wanted to do it, and we just did it.
Was it brewing for a while, or did it sort of just come together quickly, like the idea for the record label?
The idea was a friend of mine, Julian, who also sings on two songs of the album, of the Emissary of Suffering album. He just, after I asked a few labels that I personally know, and they were all like, it's pandemic, and I'm not so sure if I want to do it. And then he was like, come on, if no one wants to do it, I'm going to start a record label and I will release it. And I was like, this sounds like a good, I mean, stupid, but good idea. I will join you. And then another friend of us just jumped on, and then we got it all together, and we were really, really happy that we were able to get the record out, because I don't know if you or the readers, listeners, know that the whole situation with the pressing plans for vinyl is insane at the moment. We have like around 1 year or 1.5 years to wait to get our LPs done because of all the major releases that are being put out on vinyl at the moment. It's insane.
Well, thank you so much for meeting with me today.
Thank you so much for the interest in the band.
I'm looking forward to hearing this album when it comes out, and I'm understanding it'll take its time, and that's just fine.
Yeah, sure.
So, yeah.
Take All right. Care. Yeah, you too. Have a good time, and maybe if we ever got to play in Canada, you should come.
Yeah, maybe I'll meet you one day.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Okay. Bye-bye. Thank you for the interest.